Watch. They cut the whole nation. God said, don't let them move until they're whole. Until the pain has assuaged. And then let them rise up as my army. And I will give you the strategies of battle. And then he said, now, this day have I rolled away the reproach of Egypt. Are you ready, Resurrection House? I'm opening your eyes. Before I further in my text, I want you to see something. Because God gave us covenants in this house as a gateway to resolve all the generational issues you and I are contending with. But yet, when things happen for you to practice that covenant, you take offense. And some people even leave the church. You don't know, you just went back into the wilderness. You are supposed to take that wrong because of God and the power of God. Hey, my God. Watch. What am I trying to show you? Had they made covenant with God in the wilderness, a whole lot of things would have changed. Okay, he said you didn't get it. Watch. God had to endure an entire nation for 40 years who were non-covenant, uncircumcised, and yet they were God's people. That's why Paul says, I do not frustrate the grace of God. God said to me, my biggest problem is man. Everything else obeys. But with man, I'm caught between my love and my judgment. And I have to keep managing it. And I have to endure him stiff-neckedly walking around and refusing to submit to me. And Jesus has to stay the Father from his anger. Don't kill them yet. I know how it is. That's where we get all the delays in the kingdom from. Because God is waiting on one person. Sometimes it's just one person who will just refuse. After a while, I told you, he drove away half of this church. And I thought something terrible had happened to me. So, no. I drove them away so I can bless you. They're hindering me. He said, because they're here, but they're not submitted to you. They are equals. They have their own mind. They're not following. They thought that what I was doing, one of the leaders, the rebel leader, said that he tries to get you in these meetings to get you to think like him. And when you don't think like him, he says you're a rebel. They didn't know I was trying to teach them what God taught me. Amen. You've been non-covenant all your life. You came from families with no covenant. And God brought you here. I was behind the church blowing out leaves. He screamed at me. I don't want churchgoers from you. I want sons. Amen. And he started teaching me what to teach you. And when I started, they said, I'm trying to make them think like me. Oh. Why would you even join the church if you are not going to think like me? Is it not the thoughts in my mind that was given to me that's producing what you are enjoying? Because God has to change your mind before he can bless you. Otherwise, your mind is an enemy. Isn't that what Romans 8 tells you there? He said, those that are in the flesh cannot please God. He said, because the fleshly mind is enmity against God. So your mind has to be changed. And it's even more challenging because the rebel himself is speaking in tongues. Moving right along. See now, had they circumcised their children and kept covenant with God, the entire journey in the wilderness would have been a totally different experience. God would have descended and the things they had to murmur about before he solved would have been solved automatically. Watch, they did not know they were the ones creating their problems. Like many of us don't know we are the ones creating our problems. It was the non-covenant that caused the provisions to keep lacking. Because in a covenant relationship, God gives you the dictates of the covenant. And when you keep them, things work the way they are supposed to. That's what you see me doing. I keep practicing those things you taught me. And things just keep working. Hallelujah. Things just work. And some of them are so basic. Wash your car. If you're about to give me a ride and you start apologizing and gathering up stuff, it's not me you're worrying. The glory has been grieved all the time you are walking around with your dirt or driving around and then cursing the people that are caught in front of you. Let me throw that in, hallelujah. Since I know that crazy driving is everywhere. Sometimes I have to continue to pray down the road because I see near accidents. Yes. Somewhere these people are driving. Yes. Yes. We are all speeding. Yes. Come on, raise your hands too. We are all guilty. But my God, if I'm already driving 80, how are you going to go past me like I'm walking? Even me, the sinner, is calling you out as the biggest sinner. My God.
Come on now.
I said, Lord, please, please. Because it goes, oh. And then the tractor trailer. I said, no, this thing is not about to fall on me. In Jesus' name, even though I'm not in it. And it straightened out. Thank you, Lord. I hurried up and passed them. I don't know if the guy is asleep or what, because he's wandering into my lane. And then all of a sudden, he was going so fast and he's trying to. I said, oh, it's about to fall. I said, in Jesus' name. And then when he slowed down to get back control of it, I said, okay, Lord, this is my chance. I don't want to experience anything like that. He was carrying massive air conditioners. Can you imagine if one of them falls in front of my car? Hallelujah. I had to release my grace forward. Amen. To stabilize that bad boy. Amen. So I can get back safely. Amen. Glory to God. Now watch. Let me take you deeper into this message. Look at Philippians. I asked you all to put it up for me. You got it? Philippians 3:3. Okay, I'll read King James. They will put up New Living Translation. Watch. He says, Philippians 3:3 says, for we are the circumcision which worship God in the Spirit and rejoice in Christ Jesus. And have no confidence in the flesh. New Living says, we who worship God by the Spirit of God are the ones who are truly circumcised. We rely on what Christ Jesus has done for us. We put no confidence in human effort. Watch. What they experienced when they were cut physically, you experience when your heart is cut. Yeah. Theirs was in the body. Yours is in the heart.
Amen.
Make sharp knives. Cut them. And when they see the scar, they remember their covenant. When they remember the pain, they remember. He said, those of us who worship God by the Spirit of God, not those of us who worship God by our minds. He said, these are the truly circumcised ones. So you have to ask yourself, am I circumcised? Am I a non-covenant man? Even though I tithe, have I been cut? Is my shenanigans and these things you learned growing up still dominating you? Have they been cut out yet? Because there's no way they can be cut out except a sharp knife is used. And many of you cannot handle a sharp rebuke, which is how things are cut out of you. I told you one of the things I learned in educational psychology of, or you call it fundamentals of instruction, in flight school, is that the law of intensity is how you remember things. Things that are vivid and memorable. They give you anchor points to hold on to knowledge. You have to be cut. And you don't forget it. We all like praise, but you don't remember praise. You remember that wounding comment. Well, I have all these medicos here. You know, they say you got this massive brain lobe, and it's all a pain lobe. That the pleasure lobe is some little thing at the back of your cerebral whatever. Is it, what do you call it? Give me one of your big names. Is that cerebral vortex? Or cerebral hemisphere? Oh, this is the easiest one I've ever heard. It didn't sound boom, 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 boom. That's the way medical names sound. I tell them I prefer aviation because it's straightforward. And when you hear the name of the thing, vacuum pump, you know what it does. Not a bing, 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 bing. Oh, Lord. Arch. So those of us that walk by the Spirit, you don't know how deep that statement is. Because the Holy Spirit is present, but that doesn't mean you're submitted to Him. I was explaining something to my leaders and at the board meeting yesterday. I said, you know, when life happens, when painful things happen, and they pierce you. Actually, I didn't even tell you all this yesterday. But let me start from there because that's where he's starting. He said, that tells you that your shield of faith is broken. Because he said the shield of faith should quench that thing. When it comes, it hits that shield and it falls down powerless. But when we go around and easily wounded and hurt, we are saying that our faith is not developed. But we don't know that's the testimony we are given. That's the first thing. I said the second thing he's telling you is that your mind is now stronger than your spirit. And the only way to fix it is to stop and start reading the word and praying. 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 Until your spirit man regains control. Amen. How do you know your spirit man has regained control? When something happens, woo, your spirit answers. Before your emotions kick in. Amen. There's an unction that responds. Amen. There's a word of faith that pops out of you. Amen. That's when you know your spirit man has regained control. Hallelujah. Amen. Huh? Satan shoots a thought, a negative thought, an accusatory thought against God or against you personally. And your spirit man barks at him. No. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. God is faithful to me. Amen. live or die, I'll praise the Lord. Job said, though he slay me, yet will I trust him. Hallelujah. Your spirit man will answer. That's what I told you last Sunday. When that my brother and I, well, the first time, I was on my way to Bible study. And I got a phone call that my mother died. And I thought, if I go back home and call somebody else to teach Bible study, then how would they follow my faith? God said they should follow. In other words, my faith should be so clear, visible, that you should follow it. I came to church anyway and taught Bible study. And in the middle of it, I blurted out that my mom just passed. And the people were shocked. They said, how is that possible?
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Glory to God. You actually have to do it.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Now I'm getting full. You have to do it.
Amen.
So heaven will shine off.
Amen.
So that's a faith man, not a talker. But you believe what you say.
Amen.
We are the circumcision. Why? We've allowed him to cut out all our issues and our shenanigans and our family devils. Because everybody has them until you defeat them.
Amen. That's right.
Amen.
These people did not know. 40 years out of Egypt, they didn't know that Egypt was still on them. Do you know what's hanging on you? That's what I'm preaching off of you. Why is it that you are stuck in what you believe and can't nobody get you to change your mind? It's a devil holding you. I said that some Sundays ago. Two ladies over here walked out. I said, yeah, just confirming what I said. It's the demons chaperoning you out of the service so they can remain. Need to come back and sit down so I can cast them out. Walking off don't change anything. Watch now. I have so many scriptures to show you. They're laughing. Okay, let me go to Titus so you can see. The exciting thing is that when God starts demanding covenant, he's saying, you are hindering me for doing the greater things. I want you to get into covenant with me so you can see what I can do. Hallelujah. And then you learn not to put your mouth on holy things. Now watch. Titus 1. Paul, a servant of God. And what? An apostle of Jesus Christ. According to the faith of God's elect. And the acknowledging of the truth which is after godliness. In hope of eternal life which God that cannot lie. Come on, beloved. He didn't say the God that doesn't lie. He said he? He said it's impossible for God to lie. That's why when things happen and it doesn't seem to accord with what he said, we know we can never look his direction.
Amen.
We must look our way.
Yes.
He cannot. These scriptures are given to you to sharp your spirit, man. So when the enemy tries to pierce you with his lies, the world will answer from your spirit. God cannot lie. You to jump in the lake and drown over there. Okay? Look at what he just dropped for me to ask him. If you don't trust me now, he says, how can you be sure then that you'll enter into eternal life?
Wow.
Who's going to be there at death? Where are you headed? I said that I will stick my mic on ladies. And that just came back to me. Hallelujah. So I want to have a quick thing. So if you're a woman, just line up here. Hallelujah. Watch. The Holy Spirit said, lift up my hands. Lord, let the fire fall. Fall. Lift your hands. Glory to God. Come, come, come quickly. Fulfill the covenant I made. You see how these things happen? You wait until. Hallelujah. Go home celebrating. Your prayer lives will never remain the same. You'll be praying up a storm. Beloved, did you hear that? It is impossible for God to lie. The God that cannot lie promised the salvation we have now received through faith. Remember, the promises were made thousands of years ago before Jesus came to fulfill it. Men lived and died, even though some of them lived 900 years, 700, 800. Ooh. Hallelujah. I wish we had a chance even at 120. That's what God said. Moses said through travail and sin and rebellion, 70. If by reason of strength, 80. But God said 120. I've seen people over 100, thank God. But a Copeland is believing God for 120. He cannot lie. The way he said it, that's the way it will be. The end times that people talk about will happen just as he said, but not like people think. Glory to God. There shall be a massive harvest, is all I'm telling you all. All you prognosticators and imagining these things, there will be a move of God that like the earth has not seen. Yes. The glory will cover the earth as the waters cover the sea. That's a mystery in itself. Because when you see the sea, you say you see water, you say that's the sea. He said the waters are covering the sea. That's something. He said that God was command the sea to give up its dead. These are mysteries in the Word of God. Have you gotten a taste? Gilgal! Gilgal! Is the cry of the voice of resurrection this week for your life. The children of Israel left Egypt 40 years later. Egypt was still hanging on them. Many of us have been saved for years, but Egypt is still hanging on. What is your Egypt? the demons and the things running in your family, generational curses, craziness, attitude, drama, divorces, all kinds of things, children out of wedlock, all this craziness that Satan continues to repetitively recreate in our lives. Gilgal, the covenant, is the answer. God said, I've rolled away the reproach of Egypt from you. 40 years after they left it. Hey, you need to send your Gilgal offering today and say, Apostle, pray for me. Let these reproaches roll off of me. Let these hindrances roll off of me. Put your best seed in the mail. Go to our website, use the Zelle, use whatever. Rush your seed. Hallelujah. And if you meet the standards God gave me, I'll send you a prayer cloth. Hallelujah. Amen. Let Gilgal come to you in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. We have Bible study tonight, 7 p.m. to 9 p.m. Come study the Word of God. It will bless your life. As I said, we just finished the Conquest Conference. It was amazing. The move of God was tremendous. Very rare indeed. We will show you excerpts. Our baptismal service, hey, it's one on earth, I keep saying. Or one in America, I don't know. You just have to see for yourself the way the glory of God moving on the water, moving on the people. And you go and touch the water, boom, the glory falls on you. People laid out on asphalt for 2 hours in the sun, this 100-degree sun, and don't care. Ooh, blessed be God forever. Hey, all we have to do is make the sacrifice to bring it to you. It's for you to take it, submit to it, and receive it for you and your family. If you refuse, hey, we will keep trucking. The day will come when resurrection will be in high demand. We give God praise. We love you. We'll continue to believe God for your breakthrough as you partner with us or sow your seed in covenant. In Jesus' name receive. Amen. We'll see you tomorrow. Bye-bye. Come.